Well, brothers and sisters, and also guests with us this afternoon, do you have a favorite meal? Do you have a favorite meal? And if you do, how often could you eat it? I once had 8 days in a row a bacon cheeseburger. I really like bacon cheeseburgers. We were on holidays and we traveled light, and so we were eating out every night, and I had a bacon cheeseburger 8 days in a row. One of the ways I compliment my wife when I like some food that she makes, I say, I could eat that once a week. I could eat it regularly. Well, the Lord's Supper is a meal. How often could you eat it? That's a question that brings us into a debate over the frequency of celebrating the Lord's Supper. Very common thing to do when it comes to the Lord's Supper. And as we look at that question of the frequency of our celebration, we see on the one hand that the New Testament seems to be saying that the church participated in the supper when they met for worship each week. Yet on the other hand, there is no command saying we must have it every week. We just read in Scripture, as often as you eat and drink. As often. And so this is a question, it's an important question, it's an interesting question, at least I think so, I hope you do too. It's an important question, but it's not really the root question that we should be asking about the Lord's Supper. Because you see, while this gets brought up, this is only the presenting question. But really the real questions that we need to ask is, what's actually going on in the Lord's Supper? What are we doing in the Lord's Supper? So that's what we're going to look at this afternoon together. And we're going to see three things: that the Lord's Supper is a memorial. Also that the Lord's Supper is a means of grace for the strengthening of our faith. And finally, that the Lord's Supper is a foretaste of the greater supper to come. So brothers and sisters, this meal is a blessing to all believers. And quite simply, it is the best meal that you have ever had. So let's begin by looking at that first thing. The Lord's Supper is so good for us because it reminds us of the past. First point in your bulletin, it reminds us of the past. Our text here, 1 Corinthians 11, says in verse 24 and 25, do this in remembrance of me. In remembrance of me. First of all, Christ is saying, do this. He is commanding us to observe the supper. It's not an optional thing, it's a command. And so we do so. But particularly, we are remembering him, he says. And so when you see the bread and wine, we don't have it here right now, of course, but imagine you're in church, you're looking at that bread and wine. What are you thinking of? Well, you're thinking of him. You see that bread, and you think of his body broken and offered for us. His body, although his legs were not broken, that the scriptures might be fulfilled, we read that in John, his body certainly was broken. It was abused, it was beaten, it was torn. His body was broken. Of course, the spear pierced his side, and then his blood poured out. And so we see the wine, and we think of his blood pouring out of his side. He was poured out. He poured out himself as an offering for us. And so we think of that imagery, as we think of, as we see the bread and the wine. And this is actually the function of sacraments. We saw this a little bit a few weeks ago, but sacraments, you'll remember, are visible signs and seals that speak to our senses, our external senses. And they do that in a way that strengthens the spoken word. And now specifically when we look at the Lord's Supper, it's speaking to our senses of God's promise of the forgiveness of sins and eternal life through the work that he accomplished on the cross. And so as often as we eat and drink, we do this in remembrance of him. Is that it? Is that all? Well, I've already said no, but many people think so. Do you? You know, this kind of thinking dates back already to the early Reformation period. And currently, as we look kind of at churches and we look at our context, this is the most popular way of approaching the Lord's Supper. That it is purely symbolic. We say that the bread and wine are not the body and blood of Christ. They're not the real body and blood of Christ. And we say that in the context of transubstantiation, that big word most of us learned, if we grew up in the church, that is, when we were young, and we wonder, what is that exactly? But that Roman Catholic teaching that the bread and the wine actually become the body and blood of Christ. And as a reaction to that, we say, no, that's not true. It's purely symbolic. The Lord's Supper functions only as a memorial. This is the most popular view today. Well, brothers and sisters, let me ask you, how often do you want to go to a memorial service? Well, the answer is you go for the minimum. You do go to memorial services. You will go when somebody dies. A couple of us, at least a few of us maybe, were at one just this past week. But you don't want to do that all the time. You don't want to be going to memorial services regularly. Because it's not really a celebration. But the Lord's Supper is a celebration. You see, we don't always remember this aspect of it. We are reminded of what Christ did. Yes, that's true. But it's what he did for you. This is my body, which is for you. And so that means, therefore, that it's not just a reminder, but it assures us. That was that second word that our catechism used. The Lord's Supper, it reminds us and it assures us. What does it assure us of? It assures us of our participation in the body and blood of Christ. That word participate is so important. Participation. And now for all of us here who are professing members of Christ's church, we participate in the supper each time we celebrate it. Physically, we participate in it. The elders come by as they're administering the supper, and they have the bread on a plate, and we all take a piece of bread. We hand the tray back to the elder or down the line. Same thing with the wine. We physically pick up the cup, and then as I say the words that I say, we all eat, and we all drink, and we're participating physically. We have taste in our mouth. We have feelings in our fingers. Our senses are involved. But you see, all of this assures us then that Christ died for me. Christ's body was broken for me. His blood was poured out for me. And so our physical participation signifies our spiritual participation. That the Spirit has caused us to be united with Christ, with his body and blood, to share in his body and blood. We share in Christ. And as we think of that word, as we think of that phrase, we share in Christ, does that not excite you? That we share in him. It should. It should excite us all. Because as our catechism so wonderfully said, the last sentence we read, his suffering and obedience are definitely ours, as definitely ours as if we had personally suffered and made satisfaction for our sins. That's what we mean when we say we share in Christ. It's incredible. And so this spiritual union which we have in Christ is so precious. It should be so precious to us. Our life is in him. And there is nowhere that this is more clear than the Lord's Supper. Now, you hear sermons, and sermons are good, and they're necessary, they're essential, and you can get great benefit from them. God works through the preaching. He works through the preaching to create faith in the hearts of the listeners. And so we say that preaching is a central place in the worship service. But you know that the bread and wine are such good symbols representing Christ's body and blood, and so they speak to our senses in a way that the preaching cannot. Bread and wine, as we think of bread and wine and how appropriate they are as symbols, bread and wine were staples of Mediterranean culture. They're common items that would be on every table, every mealtime. They're things that were needed for life. But you know, it's not just that they were necessary for survival. That was not the only function of bread and wine. But they were also a sign of blessing from God. We read in Psalm 104, a psalm of praise to God for his creation. Psalm 104 says, he causes grass to grow for the livestock and provides crops for man to cultivate, producing food from the earth, wine that makes human hearts glad, oil to make the face shine, and bread that sustains human hearts. Wine, oil, and bread. And then Psalm 128, how happy or how blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. You will surely eat what your hands have worked for. You will be happy or blessed, and it will go well for you. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house, your children like young olive trees around your table. And so you see both of these psalms in different ways speaking of the blessings of God, and it mentions these three things, olive oil, bread, and wine. They were all essential items, food items, but they're also a sign of prosperity. They still are for many people. Well, here's what we're saying. God gives physical earthly life. And as a support for that physical earthly life, he gives physical earthly bread. But you know, God gives spiritual life as well. And so as a support for that spiritual life, he gives us spiritual bread, bread from heaven. And so Christ Jesus is that bread. John 6, he's the bread from heaven, the manna that his people need. He is the one who nourishes and refreshes our hungry and thirsty souls with the true food and drink of life eternal, with himself. And so I ask you, I ask myself, do you feel nourished and refreshed when you participate in the Lord's Supper? Do you feel nourished and refreshed? It's not just a memorial. And as we think on that, that brings us again to this question of the frequency, which we brought up at the very beginning. Because you see, if the Lord's Supper is spiritual nourishment, in the same way that food and drink are physical nourishment, then it stands to reason that we would want to have it regularly. Now, you don't need to be eating and drinking all the time if you think of earthly physical food. You don't need to be doing that all the time. In fact, I always say lunch is the least important meal of the day. That's my personal take on the whole breakfast is the most important meal. It's possible that you eat a little bit and you skip lunch and so on, but eventually you need to eat food. We need to eat regularly. We need to be sustained and nourished daily. And so, as we look now again to spiritual nourishment, and we look at the practice of the early church, we see that they did it regularly. In Acts 2, at the end of Acts 2, that's Pentecost, we read that the believers met for the apostles' teaching, but also for the breaking of bread and for prayers as well and fellowship. But when it says the breaking of bread, that's not just a way of saying they were simply eating a meal, though probably they were eating a meal as well. Now, we would maybe say that about breaking bread. We would maybe use that as a way to speak of a meal, perhaps. But they didn't do that at that time. This is a reference to the Lord's Supper. They met for the teaching and they broke the bread. Then Acts 20, we read in Acts 20 that the believers gathered, important word, gathered together on the first day of the week to break bread. There's three things going on there. And as we think of gathering, believers gathering, and as we think of the first day, we understand that that's talking about worship. And so we would think it would say that they gathered together on the first day of the week to worship. But in fact, it says that they gathered to break bread, and most people understand this, most scholars understand this to be saying that breaking bread there is understood by the people as a short form for worship itself. It was such a normal thing, it was such a regular thing that it was able to be used as a description of worship in that way. And so it was regular. Was it weekly? Well, we have to say not always in history. In the ancient church, yes. But in the medieval church, no. In fact, in the church prior to the Reformation, The Lord's Supper was twisted, it was abused, and it was withheld. It was very hard for a lay person to regularly take the Lord's Supper, and particularly the wine. So the Reformation came, and the Reformation restored biblical teaching on the supper. And you know, we have one reformer we often speak of, John Calvin, who said it was his desire to do the Lord's Supper at least weekly, at least. But then as we look at the historical reality, we want to say that it wasn't done weekly. It hasn't been done weekly everywhere. Quarterly has been very common also in our tradition. But Jesus doesn't specifically command a certain amount of frequency. So that's not the point. What is the point? The point is we are spiritually in need of nourishment. We regularly need it. And you know, as you think of that in relation to the word being preached, that's why we come every week to church and even twice to hear God's word preached. And we say we want to be nourished through the preached word. And if things are going well, members will say that they feel nourished as they leave church. We look to the preached word for nourishment regularly. But then we should also desire the nourishment that comes alongside of the preached word, from the visible word, from the sacramental word. You know, as believers, our life is in Christ. We live in Christ. We live by the power of the Spirit. And you think to this morning and what we looked at with walking in the way of the Spirit and living by the Spirit, bearing His fruit. How are we strengthened by the Spirit? How does He work His grace in us? Well, in various ways, but primarily through the means of grace, through the means of grace, the preaching and the sacraments. That's what Scripture tells us. So the Spirit works through the supper. It's not just a memorial, but He works through the supper to strengthen your faith and my faith, brothers and sisters. He strengthens the bond of your union with Christ. That's what's happening in the supper. And as He does so, He empowers you to walk in His ways. So the Lord's Supper points us to the past. The Lord's Supper is for the present. But it also helps us to look forward to the future. It leads us to look forward to the future. 1 Corinthians 11, we read in verse 26, that as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till He comes, or until He comes. You see, this is not just a memorial service for someone who died, but Christ is alive. And we're to recognize that Christ is alive. And the fact that Christ is alive also helps us to see that Christ is coming back. And after He comes back, what's going to happen? We're going to celebrate with Him with a great feast. Jesus says in Mark 14, as He's instituting the Lord's Supper, after presenting the wine to His disciples, He says, "Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." See, what He's saying there is in His new creation kingdom, Jesus will feast with us. Did you know that? Have you thought much on that? That Jesus will be there and all the saints from all times and places, and we'll have a great party, a great celebration. And when we celebrate the Lord's Supper, it is a foretaste of that great banquet to come. And so it'll be a great blessing to be there, won't it? Jesus gives a parable to this effect. He speaks of a parable of a great banquet. There's a rich man, and he invited many people to come to his banquet. Some of them said, "No thanks. I'm too busy. I just got married, and there's lots on the go. I'm busy at work. I can't come." So other people came, people of all backgrounds, of all status. And they came. They were compelled to come in and take a seat at the table. So Jesus is talking about salvation, of course, here. And He says, "Blessed is everyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God." Blessed. And brothers and sisters, we can then say too, blessed are all of those who are united to Christ by faith. And as we think of this union that we have with Him, we are His and He is ours. He is the bridegroom and we are the bride, right? That's such a pervasive analogy, illustration in Scripture. He's the bridegroom, we're the bride. Well, right now, we are in the engagement phase. We're engaged. But when he returns, it's going to be the consummation, marriage. And so then we're going to have a feast, just like we do now for banquets or for marriages. We have these banquets. We're going to do that then as well. As the angel said to the Apostle John in Revelation, and so also says to you and me, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Blessed. So for now, we eat here. We eat bread and wine on earth. Jesus remains in heaven. We're eating here. This is only a foretaste. It is a sampler meant to whet our appetites for the great feast that is coming. But what a meal this is. What a meal this is. It reminds us of what Christ has done for us in the past. It assures us of Christ's work for us and then thereby nourishing us in the present. And it promises us Christ in the future. And we need this. We are pilgrims on a journey, right? We're traveling through the wilderness. So we're going to need nourishment as we make our way to the promised land, as we think of this illustration. Again, another pervasive illustration within Scripture. As we travel through the wilderness to the promised land, imagine a traveler in the desert who saw an oasis and passed by the oasis or didn't take much interest in the oasis. That'd be foolish. And likewise, let's not fast while he says, come and eat. It's not fast. So come to the table. Come to the table as often as you can. Remember him, his death, his work for you. Be strengthened in your union with him. And then also celebrate with a view to the future. That future when we and Christ and all the church will celebrate together in the new creation. Amen.